so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show.
So we've opened our voices in praise, and let's now open our hearts into God's presence. The prayer of preparation. Is that going to be on the screen, Gordon, or just
these are the ones you should have.
Okay, yeah. So let's say together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amidst all the noise and all the voices that speak to us this week, let's listen first and foremost to our Lord Jesus Christ. For our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
In these days, these challenging days, in our first days of 2021, things can be a bit pressurising. Quite a few folk feel weary, and those are the times when we perhaps behave as we don't really want to behave. So let's just bring to the Lord areas where we want to offer him our confession, seek his cleansing, want him to realign us into his will for our life. And so we say together, most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen.
Loving Christ, hanged on a tree yet risen in the morning, scatter the sin from our souls as the mist from the hills. Begin what we do. Inform what we say. Redeem who we are. For in Christ we place our hope, our great hope, our living hope, this day and evermore. Amen. Amen.
And we have our special prayer set for today, our collect prayer, which has just come up for you now. And so let's say together, Eternal Lord, our beginning and our end, bring us with the whole creation to your glory, hidden through past ages and made known in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now we're going to have our reading now, and this morning it's being brought to us by Sue Hall.
You have to unmute yourself, Sue. There we go.
Can you hear me? Okay, the reading this morning is John 1, 43 to the end. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, follow me. Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Nathanael said to him, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Philip said to him, come and see. Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no deceit. Nathanael said to him, how do you know me? And Jesus answered him, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. Nathanael answered him, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Jesus answered him, because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree. Do you believe? You will see greater things than these. And he said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. This is the word of the Lord.
Okay, so let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we come now to this word of yours, may it inspire us, may it strengthen us, and may it change us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Just to say, we're going to be doing things a little bit differently this morning, which is that I'm now recording the sermon, which is going to be published separately elsewhere. And after our service, Julia and I are going to have a Q&A session on the sermon. So Julia can ask questions, and we're going to publish that on Facebook. And that'll be something that you can join in with and maybe raise your own questions, which I will pick up later and maybe come back at you with if there's things about the sermon that are unclear. Also, during the talk, I'm going to pause, mainly because people keep wanting to come into the room, but I'm going to pause and just ask a question. And we can either answer by unmuting ourselves, which might be a bit cacophonic, or just by posting in the chat box. It's up to you, but you'll see as we go along. So lots of things have changed over the last year, and we were all talking about we were looking forward to 2021. But of course, the one thing that didn't happen in 2021 was the January sales. No queuing outside Next at 6 o'clock in the morning. And if you have been buying clothes, you know it's now a risky business. And I'm not talking about pastoral care, because if you buy online or even if you go into a shop, you have to guess your size. For example, if you even if you go into Marks and Spencer's, if you do, you can't go into the changing rooms. You have to guess. And so it's a bit of an adventure buying clothes. I've noticed that Amazon have now started saying things, this producer, this guy tends to underestimate your size. So go one size up if you're buying from them, which is interesting. The thing is that we'd be very miffed if manufacturers insisted that there was only one size, that one size fitted all, which of course it doesn't unless it's Lycra, and even then. And if you were told by a shop, I'm sorry, sir, you've got the wrong size of body for our clothes, we'd be particularly miffed. Well, today's passage in John's Gospel it shows that God is not in the business of one size fits all. Today's passage illustrates records a unique encounter between a man called Nathanael and a man called Jesus. And actually, if you read through John's Gospel in particular, you'll find a number of unique encounters. And that when Jesus meets people, whether it's a woman at a well or Nicodemus or Mary and Martha at the tomb of Lazarus, he doesn't have just one size fits all response. He meets people where they are, with their problems, their questions, their difficulties, their objections, because it's not a case of one size fits all. Now, John's Gospel begins with a confident declaration that all of life's questions, all of life's problems, and all of life's purposes can be answered, solved, and fulfilled in Jesus. It's a bold claim. And the prologue offers the invitation and the challenge to everybody to put their faith in Jesus and to discover these truths for themselves. But as John's Gospel unfolds, we find that that prologue is put into practice in particular ways, depending on the particular people. So first up is Nathanael. But before we get to him, we need to note the role played by Philip in this story. Philip was a follower of John the Baptist who has responded to the invitation to follow Jesus. And now he shares his newfound faith with Nathanael. But his enthusiasm for Jesus is met with skepticism and disbelief and a put down from Nathanael that could have possibly have knocked Philip for six. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? And that's not as casual as it sounds. That really is a put down. It's a bit like when you say to somebody, look, I've become a Christian. And they say, oh, you don't go to church, do you? What a loser. And so my first question, this is where I'm going to pause, is, do you know any Nathanaels? Have you shared your faith with anyone who knocked you back, who basically told you to get stuffed, or who belittled your faith and your enthusiasm for it? Anybody had a situation like that in their lives? If you have, you can post it on the chat box. And maybe in coffee, we can talk about it later on. I see some people are coming up with stuff. And the thing about it is that when you get knocked back, it makes you reluctant to do it again with anybody, but particularly with that one person. My experience has been with my brother Stuart. He's knocked me back more than once when I've tried to share my faith. And the irritating, annoying thing is that he's better at knocking me back than I am with coming forward again to try and invite him to see things differently. And I think sometimes, if we're honest, the reason that we don't do a Philip is because we've been hurt in the past. So when people like me say things like, you should be out there sharing your faith, we're thinking about our Nathanaels. We're remembering the time we did it last. And therefore we feel a bit reluctant. We know we should be sharing our faith. We know that's part of the message, but actually we've been knocked back by Nathanael, and therefore we're a bit reluctant to go forward. I think in Philip, though, we find something of a solution. He doesn't get into an argument. He doesn't try to defend God or even Jesus. He doesn't get upset and defensive and therefore aggressive. He says something quite simple, quite straightforward. He says, come and see. Come and see. Can that be us, do you think? We have faith in Jesus, but it's more than just believing in a person who lived 2,000 years ago, and it's more than just believing in facts about him that are part of our kosher faith, as it were. It's not our doctrines that are important here, it's our relationship. See, the thing is, bluntly, Jesus is more than capable of looking after himself. He's more than capable of standing up for himself. He doesn't need us to defend him, if we mean by that we're having to sort of justify our faith in him. And the key thing here is that the Jesus who Philip met face to face and with whom he shared to Nathanael is still present by his spirit today. Now, of course, unlike Philip, we can't bring our Nathanaels into Jesus' physical presence, but we can bring him into our fellowship and allow them to see Jesus in us. Perhaps when it comes to sharing our faith, it's not what's sometimes called apologetics that we begin with, the kind of defending the content of our faith or proving the resurrection or talking about sin and its reality. Perhaps it begins with us just saying, come and see. And by that, I mean, don't sort of come along and just see the kind of the workings of the church or the activities we do, but through those activities, through those joinings together that we have as the body of Christ, is praying and expecting Jesus to manifest himself in us, through us, and in our times together. Our challenge, at least in the first part of this year, is how to bring people into contact with Christ, given that our physical gatherings are so restricted, whether in church or out, whether in social get-togethers or in cell groups. But actually, I do wonder, and I've been pondering this for the last couple of weeks, whether there is a strange blessing that's coming to us through this pandemic, which is that we can invite people to church without them needing to cross the threshold of a building. Now, I don't know about you, but I do remember a story I was told about an evangelistic exercise at St. John's College in Nottingham, where the class were gathering to, they were learning about sharing their faith. And the lecturer said, well, we're having a practical today. We're having a field trip. And he told them to go out and find a betting shop and put an each way bet on a horse in the 4:15 at Southall racecourse. And that was the exercise. And the class looked gobsmacked, to use Jill's word, thinking, what? We're going to go and lay a bet on a horse? And half of them said, I would never do that. I'm a good Christian. And the other half said, well, the teacher's told us to do it. We better get out there. So off they went into Beeston. And then one of them said, well, where's the betting shop? I don't even know where the betting shop is. I've never been in one before. And so the half of them then gave up at that point. Oh, I don't know where the betting shop is. And the other half looked around and they found it. And they were down to about five or six students by this stage. And four of them said, hang on, this is my parish. People might see me going into a betting shop. That's not going to do my reputation any good. I'm training for the ministry. And I think eventually one person managed to get into the betting shop. And even then he had to ask what an each way bet was all about. Anyway, they came back to the lecture room, all angry, all upset, all defensive. And the lecturer said, well, how did you get on? They said, how dare you ask us to go and lay a bet on a horse? We don't gamble. That's not Christian. And then he calmed them all down. He said, right, guys, every emotion that you've felt, every experience you've just had in the last hour, that's what people who have never been to church feel like when you ask them to church. They've never been in there before. They don't know where it is. What happens if their mates see them? They don't know what to do. They don't want to stand up or sit down. They don't know the songs. And that's still true today. We're familiar with church. We're comfortable in church. But maybe the people we're trying to bring to Christ, church is not the best place to start, except now. Because right now, you can invite your friends to church and they don't have to cross the threshold. You can invite them to church and they don't even have to tell us their name. You can invite them to church and the rest of us don't even know that they're there. Right now, some of you are on a mute in terms of your video. You can change your name. Some people are called iPad 2. Other people are called Gordon or Jill. You can put visitor rather than your name. Anything's possible on Zoom. The point is, you can invite people to church without having to bring them to church. But what you can do, and this is the challenge, is be confident enough that if they do come into our gathering, like this morning, that they can encounter Jesus, and that Jesus, who is in us, wants to encounter them. And this is the bit where we have to let go and trust. This is where we have, having said, come and see, we have to trust that God will let them see him, let them see Jesus. Yes, in us and through what we're saying and doing, but more importantly, it won't be us that they're seeing, but Christ in us, the hope of glory for the world. And I do believe that God is lining up his church to be online with outreach, to bring into our online meetings the people who might never darken the door. And when we come to see Nathan and Nathaniel's encounter with Jesus, when Philip's kind of backed out of the story, Jesus says, I saw you under the tree. And Nathaniel goes, wow, this is amazing. You must be the Son of God. And we're suddenly thinking, how come just this kind of I saw you under tree has moved from can nothing good come out of Nazareth to you are the Son of God? It's not because of a vision, a sight of Nathaniel under the tree. It's a sight of Nathaniel under the tree and what Nathaniel was thinking about, what was going on in Nathaniel's head, what was going on in the inside, not just the outside. Jesus doesn't mean he merely saw him in the seeing sense. He's telling Nathaniel that whatever was going on inside Nathaniel when he was under that fig tree, he, Jesus, knows all about it and is in fact the one who makes sense of it. We don't know what was going on in Nathaniel, but whatever it was, his discovery that Jesus knows all about it turns him around and changes him utterly. And this is the exciting thing about evangelism today. We don't need to know what's going on inside our friends. We may have an inkling because we know them well, but Jesus knows utterly. And we have a prayer, don't we, that we often use in church. May Jesus meet you at the point of your deepest need. Well, that's exactly what Jesus can do. And he doesn't actually need us to do it. He may bring us in alongside, you know, to take the journey on. But if we have confidence that Christ's love for our friends is as deep as his love for us, then we can step back and let Jesus take over. We can let God do the convicting rather than us doing the arguing. So Nathaniel jumps right in. And he says, you are the Son of God. You're the one I want to follow. Having held back, he now jumps in. And Jesus says, in effect, slow down. You've given up your skepticism. That's good. But now you need to sit at my feet and get to know me and who I really am. And this is why our virtual doors, as well as our eventually church doors, have to be always open. While we have to let everyone in who wants to come. Because there is a difference between conversion and discipleship. Many people respond positively when they encounter Jesus, and when that encounter leads to the solving of their problems, whether it be a healing or something else. But the encounter needs to lead to relationship if it's going to go anywhere. Otherwise, Christianity is just reduced to a consumer product. Nathaniel has been converted. Now he needs to be discipled. And that is where Philip re-enters the story. That's where we re-enter the story. Having brought Nathaniel to Jesus, Philip has stepped back and allowed his friends to meet Jesus for himself. Now Philip steps forward and, as a fellow believer in Jesus, is there to accompany Nathaniel on his journey of faith and to help Nathaniel deepen his understanding of Jesus. And Philip does this, even though he himself is a pretty new Christian. And that's where RSVP comes in. Yes, we invite people in. Yes, we expect Jesus to meet with them. And yes, wonderfully, Jesus will meet them at the point of their deepest need. But we then have to encourage them to RSVP, respond, commit. Even if that commitment at first is, well, I don't know, I need to know more, it may be coming along to one of our cell groups. It may be joining one of our courses. It might be, if people want it, that we rerun the START course or ALPHA or something similar. The point is, an encounter with Jesus has to go somewhere if it's going to change lives permanently. They need to RSVP to the call and the contact they've had with Jesus. So that is our task. That's who we are. We're Philip. Of course, at any given moment in our congregations, online, in our cell groups, whatever, there can be the Nathaniels, the people who aren't sure, the people who have perhaps been hurt by Christianity in the past, who are skeptical about the content of our faith, who are cynical about our motives. That's okay. Actually, I'd love our Sundays, our midweek prayer meetings, and everything that we do to be a mixture of Philips and Nathaniels, where the Philips are saying, okay, I understand your doubts, I respect your fears, and I'm sorry about your experiences, but come and see. And the Nathaniels, encountering Christ perhaps for the first time, and knowing that he knows everything about them, find that they are drawn into faith and into followership. So my final sort of question, just to ponder, think back to my first question, have there been Nathaniels in your life? Think about those Nathaniels who knocked you back. Can you think, can you pray, can you see yourself this week reaching out to them again? Not with argument, but with the words, come and see. And will you commit yourself next week, week after, whenever, to bring your Nathaniel, whoever he or she might be, to invite them to online worship as part of your Christian outreach? Thanks for listening.
Oh my God, plenty of food for thought there, and you may want to carry on typing things into the chat box as they occur to you in response to what Gordon shared this morning. We're going to have a next song coming up, and it is one that is here for us to listen to and reflect alongside, perhaps continuing some of those questions in the sermon, perhaps offering some of our Nathaniels up to God, maybe some of those Nathaniels have hurt us a bit, and just asking God for healing for ourselves and for growth for our Nathaniels. And maybe just asking, Lord, how do you want me to be a Philip, and where and who do you want me to be a Philip with in these next few days, weeks? So plenty to reflect on, and we'll have the song that can just help us do that.
Draw me close to you, never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my you're all.
Very beautiful song, isn't it? Even with the unexpected pause in the middle. We're going to say together now our creed, which is a very dynamic creed encouraging us to put our faith into action. And so we say, We believe in the gift of creation. God created us and this beautiful world. He has given us the gift of being creative too. We believe in the gift of love. God loves us and gave his only son for us. He wants us to use the gift of love towards everyone we meet. We believe in the gift of sharing. Jesus came to earth and shared his life with others. He has given us many things and wants us to share with others. We believe in the gift of forgiveness. Jesus died on the cross so we can be forgiven. He wants us to use the gift of forgiveness towards those who've wronged us. We believe in the gift of prayer. The Holy Spirit of God helps us to pray in Jesus' name. He wants us to use the gift of prayer in worship and service to others. Amen. So we are going to use this gift of prayer and worship and service to others. I understand that it's Kath's prayers we're going to be praying today, but Jill is going to be voicing them for us. Is that right?
That's right, Julia. That's right. Thanks. Yes, Kath has written these beautiful prayers this morning and she's asked me to read them. So let's turn to our intercessions and draw together in a moment of quietness, bringing our minds or focusing our minds and our hearts on God, to whom we are bringing our prayers and petitions this morning. And also in the moment of quietness, help us to be able to distinguish God's voice from all the other noises and sounds around us as we make ourselves available to God. So let's just pause for a moment. And the responses this morning, when I say your kingdom come, if you would like to make the response this morning is, may your will be done. And Kath's prayers this morning, she's written using the hand prayer as an outline. And so perhaps you'd like to open your hands in front of you this morning or just put your hands on your knee and just look at perhaps one of your hands. And as we look at our hands, we've got the longest finger. This represents those who stand out in our world. And so we bring before you, Lord, all the political turmoil and unrest in the United States of America. We pray that Joe Biden's inauguration goes as planned next week, including a new lighting ceremony at the Lincoln Memorial to honour people who've died during the pandemic. Lord, we especially pray for Donald Trump and his attitude of bitterness towards his successor as he refrains from attending the swearing-in ceremony. Please, God, help America. We pray for our own government and politicians that they use wisdom and integrity in this time of pandemic, Brexit and period of uncertainty for the future of our country. We pray that the decisions they have to make are for the good of everyone. We thank you for the work of our local Member of Parliament, Justin Madders, and Michael Edwardson, our town mayor, and all of our local councillors. Your kingdom come, may your will be done. And so we've used our longest finger and now our index finger. This is used at times to guide others in the right way to go. And so we pray for our nurseries, our schools, colleges and universities as they work so hard to continue with providing a good standard of education for our children and young adults. Help the staff to keep healthy and well. We pray for parents too as they provide homeschooling with all the challenges that brings. We pray for our bishops, Mark and Keith, as they lead the diocese through difficult and unprecedented times we find ourselves in. We thank you for the continuation of diocesan training in many aspects of church life. And we pray for Ricky this morning as he continues his ordination training at his placement at St. Mary's Eastern. We pray for those who are in a time of discernment, who need your help to see the way ahead that you have planned for them. Your kingdom come, may your will be done. And so we turn to our ring finger for those that we love. Dear Lord, please bless our loved ones and keep them safe, especially those who do not yet know you. Help us to recognize and understand that we have all our own unique set of God-given gifts and abilities. Give us the courage to use them wisely for your glory, no matter how small or great these gifts seem to be. Give us strength and kindle the spirit in us to follow Jesus, so that we are good witnesses for him in our dark and hurting world. We're reminded in scripture from Romans 8 verse 28 that we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who've been called for his purposes. We are called to be light bearers to those in need. And we pray that our attitudes and actions will be recognized as being different and be an encouragement to others who may perhaps be at the start of their own journey of faith. So perhaps in a moment of quiet, let's lift to the Lord those folk that we know who may be at the start of their own journey of faith, or for those who do not yet know the Lord. Perhaps praying for our own Nathaniels. Your kingdom come, may your will be done. And so we turn to our little finger and think about those needing God's healing. We pray for those who grieve the loss of a loved one. We especially pray for the families of John Martin, May Furley, Moira Parsonage, George Lowry, and Luke at the time of their sadness. May you wrap your loving arms around them and protect them as they grieve. And we ask for your healing touch to those we know who are unwell in mind, spirit, or body. And perhaps for a moment, if you'd like to lift them in the quietness of your heart to the Lord, or perhaps type them on the screen so we can all join in with the Amen at the end praying for these folk. And we particularly remember in our prayers this morning, Gemma. And we give thanks that she's now out of hospital. And we pray for God's continued healing to be upon her. We also remember in our prayers Sue Johnson and Bill Stanley. We give thanks that Bill Gadsby has recovered following his fall. Remember Jean Morris. I pray for my good friend Deb following her heart operation. Pray for God's healing hand to be upon her as she makes very slow progress. And we pray for those who look after the sick. At the Countess of Chester, over 60% of inpatients are affected by COVID-19. Causing a huge strain on the staff and resources. We thank you that we are privileged to be able to access healthcare, which is not possible in many parts of the world. Please help the staff as they grow weary and overstretched. We thank you for the vaccination programme that is being rolled out, and we pray it will prove effective in slowing down the spread of the disease, and that those vaccinated will not suffer badly if they contract COVID. Your kingdom come, may your will be done. And lastly, we think about our thumb, those who are different from others. God, you made a world full of unique people living in different cultures and countries of our world. Help us to understand the ways they are different from us and not to be fearful of those who are not like us. Help us to be tolerant of the viewpoints of others that we do not share and cause us distress. Unite us to others by your love for you as we act as peacemakers in your name. Your kingdom come, may your will be done. We are your people, God. Help us to find our identity not in what we do, but in who we are. Unite us together as your church, enable us to build your kingdom now. And we ask all of these prayers through your Son, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. So thank you to Kath for writing those beautiful prayers for us this morning. Thank you, Kath.
Might just want to keep your hands in that open position for the moment as we come to our peace amidst all the turmoil around us. We are able to receive the peace of Jesus, the Prince of Peace, that peace that the world can't offer us, but which he gives us freely. So let's be aware of receiving that peace deep within us right now. And we share it together, perhaps with those we're with physically or with on the screen if we're on our own and want to share peace with one another. So the peace of Christ be always with you and also with you. So let's share the peace.
We bless you now in the name of the Prince of Peace. Peace to you. Peace to you. We bless you now in the name of the Lord. Peace to you. We bless you now in the name of the Prince of Peace.
So we come now to our time around the table. Let's just recognize that the Jesus who died for us died for everyone. I remember the acronym COFFEE, Christ offers forgiveness for everyone, everywhere. But we need the resources of our Savior to be his instruments in the world. Communion opens us up to those resources. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. What we do here, we do in imitation of what Christ first did. To his followers in every age, Jesus gave an example and a command rooted in the experience he shared with his disciples in an upstairs room in Jerusalem. On the night on which he was betrayed, and as they were sitting at a meal, Jesus took a piece of bread and broke it. He gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body. It's broken for you. Do this to remember me." Later, after they had eaten, he took a cup of wine and said, "This cup is the new relationship with God, made possible because of my death. Drink this, all of you, to remember me." So now, we do as Jesus did. We take this bread and this wine, the produce of the earth, the fruit of human labor, for in these Jesus has promised to be present. Through these, Christ can make us whole. And now, lest we believe that our praise alone fulfills God's purpose, we fall silent and remember the one who came because words weren't enough. Setting our wisdom, our will, our words aside, emptying our hearts and bringing nothing in our hands, we yearn for the healing, the holding, the accepting, the forgiving, which Christ alone can offer. So merciful God, send now in kindness your Spirit to settle on this bread and wine and fill them with the fullness of Jesus. And let that same Spirit rest on us, converting us from the patterns of this passing world until we conform to the shape of him whose food we now share. Amen. And so we say together the prayer that Jesus taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Please join with me as we say this together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. God's holy gifts for God's holy people. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father. Amen. So with the people we're with or via the screen, let's share with one another around the Lord's table. Julie and I will be breaking bread here, but may God be with you, even though you can't see him. He's there to make you whole.
As always, we give thanks not just for this time together now, but maybe other things too, ways that God has blessed you over this week, particular things you want to give thanks for. Do put them in the chat box so we can really encourage one another. We need all the encouragement we can get. And a very wise Christian said once that what we don't celebrate withers. So let's celebrate and keep our faith growing and glowing. Do put your thanks in the chat box.
From mountain top to valley low, through laughter and through tears, surely the goodness of my God will follow all the years. For all that you have done for us, for every battle won, we'll raise a song to bless your heart for all that you have done. Failures and regrets, you've always led us home. Redemption's arm has raised us up, our triumph in the storm. For all that you have done for us, for thank you.
Okay, folks, that's fantastic. We've had some super prayers already in the chat box, but do keep going, keep the thanks overflowing. But some fabulous answers to prayer we've had and real blessings this week. Healing a friend, healing a knee, Gemma, and thanks for her ongoing healing, and pray that will continue. For lovely retreat, for the online prayers, for our faith community, for listening ears, for the vaccination program in Ellesmere Port, for our fellowship, for Cell, for supportive colleagues and a successful parenting week, and many others flowing on there. That was fantastic. So keep them coming. Just a real encouragement as we go into the next week. And we're going now to prepare ourselves for going into the next week with our closing prayer. Praying for ourselves to be as Philip's with all the Nathaniels that we meet. And so we say together, send us out into the world, Lord, to speak your words of truth. Send us out into the world, Lord, to proclaim your love and grace. Send us out into the world, Lord, to bring comfort to the weak. Send us out into the world, Lord, to be your hands and feet. We shall not fear this day, for you are with us. Wherever we might go, your light to shine ahead, your footsteps to lead the way. And so we are going to have our final song. Going forward, we trust in Christ alone.
In Christ alone.
Right, lovely song to finish with. I guess our air instrumental playing has all got a lot better in lockdown, so we'll keep practicing. We've come to the end of our service now, but not necessarily our time together. So do grab yourself a cuppa and hang around and chat. Look forward to seeing as many of you as can make it tonight to listen to Carol. We're all looking forward to hearing what she has to share with us. But meanwhile, over to you. Let's just chat and enjoy one another's company for a bit longer this morning.
You can.